Good day, everyone, and welcome to North Coast Church Online. My name is Paul, and I'm staff here at North Coast, and we are so glad that you can join us today. If this is your first time with us, a special welcome to you. Thanks so much for tuning in. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to connect with you. Please jump on our website. You'll find a tab that says I'm new and an option there to connect with us. Now, isn't our God an amazing God? He loves us just the way we are. No matter what our past is, no matter what our history is, He meets us where we are at. So let's listen to Romans 8 as we begin today. Romans 8, verses 31 and 32 says, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also graciously give us all things? Friends, Jesus Christ died for us, but He didn't remain dead. He rose up, and right now He's seated at the right hand of God, interceding for us. And so, who can separate us, or what can separate us from His love? No tribulation, no suffering, no virus, no lockdown can separate us from His love. If God is for us, who can be against us? He has graciously given us all things. Let me pray and commit our time together before we sing about His amazing love and about His amazing grace. Join with me. Heavenly Father, if You are for us, who can be against us? We thank You for the confidence that we have in Jesus, that He died and He rose again. And He's at the moment seated at Your right hand in control of all things. And so, Father, we just pray and commit our time together as we watch online, wherever we are at, as we sing, as we hear from Your word. Would You prepare our hearts? Would You speak to us? Would You draw us closer to You, Lord? Help us. Help us to know You more today. And in all that we do today, we pray that You will be glorified through Your word. In Your name and for Your glory, we pray. Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless with awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You laid down Your life. Then I would be saved. Brings that chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
He rules the nations.
He rules the nations with truth and justice. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Kids is on YouTube, so you can go watch that with the family. We hope that you are encouraged as you see in Psalm 73 that God is worth following. See you guys there.
A few days ago, I got an email in my inbox from Barnabas Fund with the following subject line: Indian church leaders call for government action after Christian father and son tortured to death in police custody. As I read the article, it turned out that this Christian man and his son had been targeted by Hindu extremists, taken into custody, and then savagely beaten to death. It's a horrifying story, but sadly, stories like this are all too common in our world today. We just don't normally hear about them. The stark reality is that for millions of Christians around the world right now, they are facing very real persecution for their faith in Jesus. And when you think about it, I mean, it's hard to imagine, isn't it? To what that would actually be like. For me to imagine if that was my family, if that was my children whose lives were in danger for being Christians. You know, thankfully, we don't face that kind of persecution at the moment here in Australia. But there are very real signs that the pressure on Christians, even here, is beginning to increase. Wedding photographers whose businesses have been put in jeopardy. Christians who have lost their job because they can't sign up to the new values statement that celebrates sin. These aren't hypotheticals. These are situations that have already started to happen here in Australia. And all of this raises the question: how do we, as God's people, respond to all of this? Whether it's pressure or outright persecution, how do we respond when it gets tough to follow Jesus? Well, today we're looking at Hebrews 11, a passage that has a lot to teach us about how we respond in the face of pressure today. Now, before we jump right into chapter 11, it's vital to understand a little bit of the bigger picture and to grasp that the book of Hebrews is actually a letter that was originally written to Christians almost 2,000 years ago in the first century AD, a few decades after Jesus' death and resurrection. And these Christians who the letter of Hebrews was written to were under huge pressure to give up on Jesus. And the reason that it was written was to help them stand firm. You can see this, for example, at the end of Hebrews 10. I'll have the verses up on the screen, but if you've got a Bible, it'd be great for you to have it open so that you can see what we're looking at in context. So looking at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 32, it says, "Remember those days, those early days after you'd received the light." It's talking when they first became Christians. When you, after you
had received the light when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times, you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. He's talking about their confidence in Jesus. Do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you've done the will of God, you'll receive what he has promised. Now, just from those verses, you can see something of the pressure they were under, can't you? Insult, persecution, prison, confiscation of property. They were facing extreme pressure for being Christians. And the author of Hebrews, he wants them to persevere. But did you notice the reasons he gives for why they should stick with Jesus? Have a look at those verses again and see, especially verses 35 to 36. Why not throw away your confidence in Jesus? Verse 35, because it will be richly rewarded. Why persevere as a Christian? Verse 36, because if you do, you'll receive what God has promised. So what the author is doing here is he's lifting their eyes to see the bigger picture. He's reminding them of what God has promised for those who stick with Jesus. The promise of eternal life, of forgiveness, of an eternity of life as it was meant to be in the new creation, once sin and death have been done away with. He's saying, keep following Jesus, because even if it means suffering now, it'll be worth it in eternity. As Jesus himself promised us in Matthew 16, be willing to lose your life for me now, and you'll find true life in the age to come. But the reality is, if you're anything like me, it's easy to lose sight of this, isn't it? Sure, this life on earth is a mere heartbeat compared to eternity, but sometimes it can feel pretty long. And yes, the world around us is temporary, but it feels so concrete. I mean, the pressures of life feel so real, while eternity can sometimes just feel abstract. And so we easily lose sight of that bigger picture, don't we? We easily become short-sighted and live as this life is all there is. Now, the author of Hebrews knows that his original readers were facing that same problem that we face. They were getting discouraged by the present hardships and losing sight of what God had promised for the future. So the purpose of Hebrews chapter 11, the whole point of it, is to encourage them with examples of people throughout history who have trusted in God, even in the face of uncertainty and hardship. People who have had faith in God and his promises and allowed those promises of the future to shape their lives in the present. And so Hebrews chapter 11 is all about faith. Faith in God and in his promises. Have a look in your Bibles with me at Hebrews chapter 11 verses 1 to 2. It says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. Now, if we want to get our heads around what this is saying, we need to clarify something important. The word faith comes up 25 times in this chapter alone, but it's a word that is extremely misunderstood in our culture today. So what does the Bible actually mean when it talks about faith? Well, when we hear the word faith today, often we think of blind faith. In fact, some people even think of faith and they'll try to define it this way. They'll say that faith is belief in something for which there is no evidence. It's It's fine to believe in things based on reasons, but as soon as you have no reason to believe in something, well, that is when it becomes faith. Now, that's a common misconception. You know, some people outside of the church will say this to say that Christians just have blind faith. But even within the church, you'll sometimes hear people say things like, oh, we don't have any evidence for God, but just have faith, as if that's a reassuring thing. It's belief without good reason. But the only problem is the Bible never actually uses the word faith to mean that. No, the word faith literally means trust. To have faith in someone is to trust them, to rely on them. Or to use the language of Hebrews 11:1, to have confidence in them and assurance that they'll do what they say. That is how the Bible uses the word faith. And we still use it that way today, don't we? For example, if someone says, have a little faith in me, what are they saying? Are they saying, believe in my existence without any evidence? Well, no, they're saying, trust me, have a little faith in me. Or if someone says, he's restored our faith in politicians, well, it doesn't mean that we've started believing that politicians exist despite evidence to the contrary. No, it means we trust in them again. We have greater confidence in them that they'll do what they say. That's what it means to have faith in someone. And it's important to realize the Bible never commends faith as something that is intrinsically good, as if faith in and of itself is somehow a virtue. Well, no, there are lots of times when faith is actually denounced in the Bible because people were putting their faith in the wrong things. They were trusting in their own wealth or strength or armies or intellect. No, what the Bible commends is specifically faith in God, and it commends faith in God because he's faithful. It commends trusting God because he's trustworthy. It commends reliance on God because he's reliable. You know, imagine if Matt Malcolm came up to me after church today and said, hey, Ben, can you lend me $100? I promise I'll pay you back next week. Now, because I know Matt and he's a pretty trustworthy guy, I'd probably say, sure, I have confidence that he will pay me back in the future. But now imagine some rando on the street came up and asked me the same thing. Well, that would be a different story. I mean, maybe you're a more trusting person than I am, but I'd probably say no. Why? Because I've got no basis for thinking that this rando is trustworthy. I've got no reason for confidence in them. Now, why are those two scenarios different? The difference is that I know Matt. I know that he has a proven track record of being trustworthy and faithful. And so I can confidently believe he'll do what he says. He'll pay me back. Now, that's not a blind faith. That's a grounded faith, isn't it? And the Bible is the same. It doesn't encourage us to have a blind faith. It wants us to have faith in God, yes, and to trust him, but to do so based on his proven track record of being faithful. And what Hebrews 11 is doing is showing us example after example of people who had faith in God to do what he'd promised to do and where God proved himself faithful. So, for example, have a look in your Bibles with me at Hebrews 11, verse 7. It says, by faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. Now, when it says he was warned about things not yet seen, what's it talking about? Well, it's talking about the flood, isn't it? In Genesis 6, God promised Noah that there's going to be a huge flood that would cover the earth. And so, because God had told him that, Noah spent years of his life building this huge boat on dry land. Now, you can just imagine someone coming up to him and being like, dude, Noah, like, what are you doing, man? Why are you building this boat? There's no water for it to even go in. You realize that we live in the Middle East, right? It's kind of dry around here. And maybe you can imagine Noah saying, oh no, it makes perfect sense. Because you see, there's going to be this huge flood that's going to cover the desert and the whole earth is just going to be filled with water and my boat is just going to start floating right off the ground. Makes complete sense. You'd be thinking, this guy's crazy. It's like what we think of doomsday preppers, building their bunkers, stockpiling baked beans and toilet paper, apparently, prepping for a zombie apocalypse. Preparing for a threat that's unseen. But of course, here's the critical difference. Unlike the doomsday preppers, who don't actually have a good reason to think that the zombies are coming. Now, if you think you have a good case for why the zombies are coming, I'd be happy for you to shoot me a message about it. I'm all ears. But no, I don't think Hollywood movies and the other things are a good basis for thinking this is something that's actually going to happen. Noah, on the other hand, did have a good reason to think that the flood was coming. Why? Because God himself had promised it. And so because Noah believed God to be trustworthy, he put his faith in him and then shaped his life in the present around what God said about the future. He couldn't see the coming flood, but his faith in God gave him confidence about what he did not yet see. And of course, just like God promised, the flood came. And Hebrews 11 points us to many examples like this. Abraham and Sarah, for example, were in their 70s when God promised them a son. And you don't need modern medicine to know that women just can't have children when they're that old. You just don't see a lot of pregnant septuagenarians walking into the maternity ward on their walking frames. And Genesis 18 tells us that even Sarah herself laughed when God made the promise. She said, no way, that's ridiculous. It seemed impossible. At the time, she didn't have faith in God that it was going to happen. And yet, have a look with me in your Bibles at verse 11. It says, and by faith, even Sarah who had weak faith and initially doubted the promise, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, that's an understatement, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. You see, Sarah knew it was impossible, and yet she chose to believe. She chose to trust. Why? Because she had blind faith? No, because she considered him faithful who made the promise. Just like me considering Matt faithful to come through with $100. Sarah's faith was grounded in the proven faithfulness of a God who had come through on his promises to them before. And this is critical for us to grasp, that the Bible does not call us to have blind faith. On the contrary, it wants us to have a grounded faith. It wants us to consider whether there is good reason to think that God is faithful, whether or not he's trustworthy. And that's really what Hebrews 11 is about. You know, some people have called it the Faith Hall of Fame. Like, wow, look at these great heroes of the faith. They had such strong faith. What amazing people. But that's actually kind of missing the point of Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11 is not a record of people with amazing faith. It's a record of how God has proved himself faithful, of why God is trustworthy. Many of the people listed in Hebrews 11, actually, when you go back to the Old Testament and read the stories, a lot of them had very weak faith. But even though their faith wasn't strong, because they put their trust in the right person, in God, he came through. And so Hebrews 11 is making this case of why God's trustworthy and therefore of why we have good reason today as followers of Jesus to believe that God will come through on his promises to us. And can you see why this is important for the Hebrews, for the original recipients of this letter in the first century AD? Well, do you remember the situation they were facing? They were being persecuted. They were facing pressure to give up on Jesus. But the author of Hebrews is urging them, do not throw away your confidence in Jesus. It'll be richly rewarded. Persevere so that you'll receive what God has promised. He's saying, hang in there and you'll receive God's promise of eternal life for all who trust in Jesus. He's reminding them, God is trustworthy. And the rest of Hebrews 11 is just driving this point home. Have a look in your Bibles with me at Hebrews 11, verse 24. It says, by faith Moses, when he'd grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to his reward. Now, if you've seen the Prince of Egypt, you can probably picture this quite well. Moses was raised in Pharaoh's household, which meant that he could have chosen to live the easy life, the life of a prince. He had that option in front of him. But instead, he chose to be mistreated along with the people of God, to join the Hebrews, the Israelites, in their suffering. Why? Did he do it because he just enjoyed suffering? No, have a look at a closer look at verse 26. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because, and here's the key, because he was looking ahead to his reward. You see, God's promises for the future radically shaped what Moses was willing to face in the present. And in many ways, the Hebrews were facing the same question as Moses, the Hebrews to whom this letter was written originally. Will they opt for the easy life? Will they cave in and conform to the culture around them? Maybe just sign that value statement, it'll be much easier. Or will they be willing to be mistreated as the people of God? Will they stand firm with Jesus, even when it means hardship and opposition and being slandered and misunderstood? In many ways, we too are faced with the same question, aren't we? Follow Jesus, even though it means hardship, even though it means laying down your life for the good of others. Or ignore Jesus, opt for a comfortable life, fitting in with the culture around you. Make no mistake, your life will be harder if you choose to follow Jesus. But if you believe God's promises, it'll be more than worth it in the age to come. It all comes down to whether or not you believe that God is trustworthy. Of course, the argument of Hebrews 11 is that God has proven himself worthy of putting our faith in time and time again. Have a look in your Bibles with me at verse 32. He writes, "And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released, so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them." You see, there is a long history of God's people who are willing to face hardships, opposition, persecution, even death, because they looked forward in faith to receiving what God had promised. And the question for us is, will we do the same? That's what God is urging us to do here. Have a look with me at Hebrews 12, verses 1 to 3. At some point, people have put a chapter division marker there, but actually Hebrews 12, 1 to 3 is just continuing the logical argument of Hebrews 11. And it's in Hebrews 12, 1 to 3 where the argument of this whole section reaches its climax. So have a look with me. It says, therefore, in light of all that we've seen in Hebrews 11, therefore, and since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And this is really the crux of the matter. Because you see, it's true that God has proven himself trustworthy countless times in history, as Hebrews 11 reminds us. But the clearest picture, the most concrete demonstration of God's faithfulness is in Jesus. And so the passage calls us to fix our eyes on him. Because when we look at Jesus willingly dying on the cross to take our punishment, we see the ultimate display of God's love for us, to make a way for us to be forgiven while still being just in his condemnation of sin. When we look at Jesus conquering death through his resurrection from the dead, we see the ultimate display of God's power to make a way for us to have bodily eternal life in the age to come. And so if we ever have doubts about God's trustworthiness or his love for us or whether he will come through on his promises, we need only fix our eyes on Jesus. Because in Jesus, God has made himself known. In Jesus, God's love, God's holiness, God's justice, God's mercy are all on display. So the Bible doesn't call us to have blind faith. It doesn't call us to close our eyes, but rather to open them, to open our eyes and see the bigger picture, to look at how God has proved himself faithful time and time again, to open our eyes and to fix our gaze on Jesus. So just as we finish up, if you're watching today and you're not a Christian, but you're maybe just investigating or curious, let me just say, it's awesome that you're here. It's awesome that you're watching. And let me assure you that as you investigate Christianity, you're not being asked to check your mind at the door and take a blind leap of faith. No, investigate. Ask the hard questions. Read the Gospels for yourself. Look at all Jesus said and did and taught. And as you do, as you investigate and open your eyes and look at the evidence, as you do, consider if you think he is worth putting your faith in. If you think Jesus is trustworthy. And if you're here today and you are a Christian, maybe you're feeling the pressure, then let me just encourage you to keep fixing your eyes on Jesus. Run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Do not throw away your confidence. It'll be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you'll receive what he has promised. Will you pray with me? Our gracious Father, we thank you for the ways that you've proved yourself faithful throughout history, and especially in the Lord Jesus. God, we admit that we so easily become short-sighted. We lose sight of the bigger picture and the eternity that lies in wait for each and every one of us. We admit that our faith is weak. Strengthen us by your Holy Spirit. Fix our eyes on Jesus. Give us your eternal perspective so that we would live lives that honor you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Kindness you have poured out in grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes. You have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but see.
You are
faithful. You are faithful forever. You will be faithful. You are. All your promises, yes and amen.
God, we can trust you with our whole heart. Lord, we sing of your faithfulness. Because of your faithfulness, Lord, we can rest in your promises.
I will rest in your promises, my confidence. Is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises, my confidence.
Oh, is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises, my confidence. Is your faithfulness, and I will.
promises, yes and amen. All your promises, yes and amen. All your promises, all your promises, yes and amen.
I hope you were encouraged by what you heard today. I just want to let you know a couple of things that are happening in the life of our church here at North Coast. Firstly, in term three, we'll be running an 8-week course called The Story of God. And this is a course that we're running in partnership with Trinity Theological College. It's a Trinity at Night unit. It'll be run right here at our church buildings. All the details are available on our website. If you jump on our website, click on the tab that says Events, you'll find the Story of God course where the details are there and you can register. Lastly, I just want to say, if you're a regular to North Coast and if the ministry of North Coast has been an encouragement to you and if you wanted to support and partner for the gospel work here at North Coast, would you jump online and click on the tab that says Give and you'll find all the details there to support the work of the gospel here at North Coast. And as we go out into this week, we've heard today that God has proven himself to be faithful and reliable. So as we step into this week, let's put our faith in him. Let's put our trust in him because he is in control of all things. Thanks for joining us today. Have a great week. We'll see you next time.